When you run a linear regression analysis, these are probably the most useful parameters that you'll get out of it. You'll do a least squares fit for the slope. In this case, it's 9.4 and the intercept is 3.0. And I've also included 95% confidence intervals for both the slope and the intercept. And if you haven't yet, you might want to take a look at the previous screencast in which I talk about in more detail what these confidence intervals actually mean. What I want to talk about in this screencast is the meaning of the p-values that you'll calculate for both the slope and the intercept. What I've generated here are some simulated data. I've collected two simulated data points at x equals 1, x equals 3, and 5, and I fit a line to it. I just did a least squares regression. And one of the questions we want to figure out is whether or not there truly is a y-intercept at x equals 0. Obviously, with the least squares fit, we would see an intercept, and that might be, in this case, we're getting a fit intercept of 3. But the question we want to answer is that significant, or in reality, in the whatever experiment we're running, is there really a y-intercept? Or is the fact that we're measuring in our least squares regression, we're calculating a value of b of 3, did that just occur by random chance due to the scatter in the data? So I simulated that data set. I generated a line, and in that simulated data set, the true intercept is actually 0, and the slope of that line, I chose a slope of 10. And I chose an error range of plus or minus 4 as the standard deviation for each of these normal distributions. So I'm going to run the simulation at x equals 1, 3, and 5. I'm going to randomly pick data points along this normal distribution, for example. And most of the data points will gather right around the mean of the distribution. And it's possible, though it's unlikely, that we'll also gather data points far away from that. And in the screencast, I'll also simulate a data set using a horizontal line. And in this case, I've got a y-intercept of 30 and a slope, of course, of 0. And I've also got normal distributions with a spread of plus or minus 4, a standard deviation of 4 on either side of it. So when you calculate p-values for the slope and the intercept of a linear regression, you're actually performing two hypothesis tests. The first null hypothesis is that the intercept is actually equal to 0. And its alternative hypothesis is that the intercept is non-zero. And similarly, the second hypothesis test, the null hypothesis, is that the slope is zero, and the alternative hypothesis is that the slope is non-zero. So in these two graphs, I am showing two cases in which the null hypothesis for the intercept is true. And in the second case, I am showing a case in which the null hypothesis for the slope is true. So in this case, on the left, the y-intercept is indeed 0. In the graph on the right, the slope is indeed 0. But in both cases, we don't ever get to know what the true line is. We're just trying to approximate it when we measure our data points. So we're trying to get as close as possible, and we're trying to figure out what these lines actually look like. So when we randomly collect data with normal distributions, it's quite possible, though it might be unlikely, that we could collect data sets in which the points were randomly selected relatively high compared to that true line. And what you would find when you did a linear regression on that, we would see a case in which the y-intercept was a great deal above zero, and we might falsely conclude that the null hypothesis is false. And if that's the case, we've made a type 1 error. Similarly, for the case on the right, when the null hypothesis is true for the slope is actually zero, it's quite possible, though maybe a little bit unlikely, that we would collect data points that look something like this, and then when you fit a linear regression to that, the line would look something like this, and when we look at that, we would say, well, the slope isn't zero, it's something negative. And in that case, we've made a type 1 error for the slope. And the p-value that you generate in both cases gives you an indication of the odds that you've made a type 1 error. And a rule of thumb is that the smaller the p-value for the intercept, the more convinced you can be that the intercept is non-zero. Or we could also say the more convinced you can be that it is significant. And similarly, the smaller the p-value for the slope, the more convinced you can be that the slope is something other than zero. And as usual, you'd typically say that if the p-value is less than 0.05, we would say that it is significant, meaning we have enough evidence to argue that the slope or the intercept are non-zero. And in the screencast, you and I both know that the null hypothesis for the graph on the left, the null hypothesis for the intercept, is true. And you and I both know that the null hypothesis, the graph on the right, for the slope is true. But in reality, we don't ever get to know that. So the best we can do is make some statistical arguments and just saying the odds that we are correct. And just so you can see it, here's a third case in which the null hypothesis for the slope is true, and the null hypothesis for the intercept is true. And what you would observe is a horizontal line at y equals 0. So when you measure data for something like this, odds are you'll find that the p-value for both the slope and the intercept are fairly large, or we'd say both the slope and the intercept are insignificant. Here's the original data set I showed you at the beginning, and I'm also showing you how I came up with that data set or how I simulated it. Again, I've got the true line, the true behavior of the experiment shown here in the thick line, and the dashed line shows the regression analysis that you would get just by performing a least squares regression. And I'm also showing up here the p-value for the intercept. And the p-value for the intercept is a great deal larger than 0.05, and it doesn't give us enough evidence to refute the null hypothesis. So it doesn't give us enough evidence to say that the intercept is something other than zero. So maybe a dirty way to explain this would be, well, we've got a little bit of wiggle room to fit the data. You could imagine, well, both of these look pretty good for the fit of the data, and they tend to bracket zero. It might be another way to think about this. And also note that the p-value for the intercept is larger than 0.05, and consequently the 95% confidence interval for the intercept will bracket 0. So the 95% confidence interval for B, the low end of that would be less than 0, and the high end is greater than 0, and because it contains 0, it's another way to say that the y-intercept is insignificant. Look at the p-value for the slope, though. It's a tiny value, 1 times 10 to the negative 4th, and what that says is that it's highly unlikely that the null hypothesis for the slope is true. It's highly unlikely that the true slope is actually equal to 0, and we measured this trend by chance. So in this case, we can clearly reject the null hypothesis that the slope is 0, and of course we would fit a line that in this case had a positive slope. And in addition, the 95% confidence interval for the slope doesn't come anywhere near zero, so we get a confidence interval that's far away from zero and consequently a very small p-value. So here's another example in which I've set the null hypothesis for the slope. I've made it true, so I've set the actual slope, the thick black line here, equal to zero, and I've generated some random data. The graph on the right is the graph that you would actually see, and the question is whether or not these data suggest that there's any sort of slope in the true experimental analysis. So you run your regression analysis, and the first thing you would observe is that the p-value for the slope is greater than 0.05, and it suggests that the true slope is not any different than zero. And again, we look at the 95% confidence interval for the slope, and that confidence interval does contain zero, and it also suggests that the slope is insignificant. However, the intercept, we get a very small p-value suggesting that there's no way that the intercept is actually equal to zero. It's highly unlikely that that would have occurred. And the 95% confidence interval for the intercept doesn't come anywhere close to zero. So to simulate this, imagine that you and 99 of your friends ran the exact same experiment and collected data. What I'm showing is a case in which the null hypothesis for the intercept is true. So the true intercept is actually equal to zero. And if we get a p-value that is 0.05 or less, then we've made a type 1 error. We've incorrectly concluded that the intercept is non-zero. So I'll cycle through, and on run number 4, we made a type 1 error. So in this case, look at the p-value for the intercept. It's 0.02. In the graph on the right, it makes it look incorrectly that the intercept is some negative value or something fairly clearly other than zero when you just look at the data themselves. And that's all you get to see in real life. You don't ever get to know that you made a type 1 error. But in the graph on the left, it becomes maybe a little bit more obvious that intercept ought to equal zero. And I've just been cycling through. And on run number 30, again, we made a type 1 error with the p-value for the intercept is less than 0.05. So I'll keep going through, and remember, we're looking for about 5 type 1 errors when I make 100 runs. It could be a little more, a little less, but on average, we'll make 5 type 1 errors. And as it turns out, for those 100 runs, ended up making 6 type 1 errors. So that means 6 times we concluded that there indeed was a non-zero y-intercept when in fact there wasn't. And again, I can do the same thing for the slope. Here I've set up the null hypothesis being true for the slope. The slope is indeed 0. So every time we get a p-value for the slope that's less than 0.05, we've made a type 1 error for the slope. So I'll cycle through like I did before, and here is a case in which we made a type 1 error for the slope. The p-value for the slope is much less than 0.05, and when you look at the data on the right, that's what you would see in real life, and when you fit a regression to that, you would say, well, clearly there's a slope, but as it turns out, it was all due to chance. It was all due to random noise in your experiment, and you made a type 1 error, but you didn't even know it. So I'll just continue to cycle through. Here's another case in which we made a type 1 error. Remember, we're looking, there'll probably be about 5 out of the 100 runs. Another case for a type 1 error. Here's another one. And here's another one on run 41. And here's another case. And typically, if you see data points that are clustered really tightly around a line, you've got higher evidence for a slope, but you could still be making a type 1 error. So actually, I already have 8 of these. We've got 9 type 1 errors on this particular one. So remember, this is all on average, up to 10 now. So in this case, we've actually made 11 type 1 errors over 100 runs. So it's not, I mean, it's all law of chance, but again, on average, we would see about 5 for every 100 runs. So I'll rerun this with 1,000 runs, and we'll expect something close to 50. And the more runs that you carry out, the closer you'll get to the true average. So here I've rerun the simulation 1,000 times just to show you that on average we'll get something close to 5% of those runs will be a type 1 error. So in this case we're close to about 50 out of the 1,000 runs we made a type 1 error. But 950 times the hypothesis was correct.